This is your second video for production of materials, and it's going to be on ethylene. So you remember from your preliminary course, fractional distillation of crude oils, and that we use boiling points to separate the different parts of the crude oil, and we use the different fractions for different things. So this picture gives you a general idea of what we use the fractions for. So the first fraction, we'll start at the very top. The first fraction we're looking at is refinery gases. Now these are things like the gas that you find in your barbecue cylinders. It's in the natural gas that we have in our homes, and it's also where the source of ethylene. So these are short-chained carbons between one carbon to about four carbons in length. The next fraction we take out, usually between 30 degrees and 125 degrees, so look at these temperatures as ball marks, you know, somewhere in between. The petrol chains are slightly longer, so we're looking at 5 carbons to 8 carbons in length. And again, this is the petrol that we use in our cars. The next fraction we're taking out is naphtha. Naphtha is a great beginning product for a lot of the chemical reactions that we use later on in this topic. So naphtha will be something that you will learn about more. It's got a medium chain in length, so about 7 carbons to 13 carbons. The next one is our kerosene. Kerosene, we know that we use it in home heating. You might have a little kerosene lamp when you go out camping. It's also the fuel that we use in aeroplanes. It's obviously not as high in demand as petrol is for our cars, so we often use kerosene and break kerosene apart to make more petrol, but I'm going to get that into the next slide. So kerosene has a carbon chain of usually around 11 to 16 carbons. The next fraction we look at is diesel. So diesel oil, we know diesel, the diesel engines, we use it for furnace fuel and things like that. Also, it's another one that's great for breaking apart into smaller ones, and usually between 15 to 18 carbons long. Just before we get into the last fraction there of residue, there is one fraction in between here, and that's our lubricating oils. So these are the things that we use to lubricate our engines, clear waxes, polishes, our paraffin waxes. And these are quite long. They're between 16 carbons to 40 carbons long. And then the very last chain, these are our residues. We don't really have much use for them. You can kind of picture them as being the black tar, and we use them for asphalt and bitumen road surfaces and things like that. They are really long chains, so you're looking at about 40 plus in terms of the number of carbons that go into these chains. So looking at oil refinery from a business point of view, each of these fractions earns the company money because they will sell residue in terms of bitumen and things like that to the RTA to make roads. They will send their diesel oil obviously to petrol companies for diesel, same with their petrol. Naphtha, they'll sell to other companies as starting products, and the same with refinery gas. So this whole process, they want to make money. Now, some of these fractions, like kerosene, for example, and even diesel oil, they're not going to make as much money as the fractions that are in high demand, like petrol. And one of the other things that is really highly in demand is ethylene. And you'll remember ethylene, also known as ethene, as our double bonded carbon with our four hydrogens. Now, this is a product that's coming out from refinery gas. Unfortunately, from standard distillation, we don't get a lot of it, but we need heaps of it. So they can sell it for a ton of money. And if they're selling something for a lot of money, they want to make more of it. So what they tend to do is to take these longer chains. So obviously, with ethylene only being a two-carbon chain, they can take these fractions that really don't make them a lot of money and break them apart to make more of the fractions that give them lots of money. So we're going to look at how we break apart these fractions to create ethylene in the next slide. So one of the ways we can do this is by a process called catalytic cracking. So the biologist among us would know that a catalyst will speed up a reaction. So we're using a foreign object to speed up the reaction, or speed up the cracking or the breaking of the longer chained carbons. in order to create ethylene so that we can get lots of money and become rich oil tycoons. So what we do, we take a longer chained carbon, and in this case I'm going to start with C15H32. So does anyone want to pause the video, take a guess at what we might call this? All right, so hopefully your guess was correct. It's called pentadecane, penta with the five and dec, so we add them together, pentadecane. And we use a catalyst to break our pentadecane apart. Now, pentadecane is from the kerosene fractions, so something that doesn't get us a lot of money. And what we do, with the aid of the catalyst, we're going to break this chain down into a 10-carbon-chained decane and a smaller 5-carbon-chained pentene. So we've created an alkane and an alkene. Now from here we still don't have ethylene. What we do is we take our pentene, so our C5H10. Let me rub that out and fix that. Where's my rubber? H10. And again, we use a catalyst to break this down into finally our ethylene and also whatever's left, our propene. So this process is all done in a single chamber. It's called a cat cracker. Lovely name. And it's all done in the one chamber with the one catalyst. And we call these zeolites. Now, zeolites are just compounds of aluminium, silicon, oxygen. You get some metal ions in there as well. But remember, catalysts don't have any impact. They're not reacting with our products here in any stage. They're simply there to increase the rate of reaction. So some of the other conditions that we need to have, it's done at 500 degrees Celsius. There needs to be an absence of O2, so it's done anaerobically, so no oxygen is present, and it's slightly above atmospheric pressure, not a lot, but we're looking at maybe 1.5 atmospheric pressures. Another process of getting ethylene is through thermal cracking, and that's using heat or steam passed through really hot tubes. So we're looking at 700 to 1,000 degrees Celsius. So we're heating water up so that we can get some steam, passing it through these metal tubes, usually just above atmospheric pressure again, and it's going to decompose alkanes into different alkenes. So we're going to get ethylene. So we're going to start with another long chain, just as an example, so C11H24. And this is called undecane. So because it's an unfamiliar one, I'll write it down here, undecane. And the addition of these really high temperatures is going to decompose our undecane, and it's going to create different fractions. So we're going to create our ethylene is what we want. We're also going to create some propene. Oh, that's a 3H6. And then what's left, we're going to just have some hydrogen sitting there. So don't forget, everything needs to be balanced. So if we actually look at this, we're going to create 4 of our ethylene molecules, which is fantastic because that's going to make us even more money if I can create this and get 4 of these ethylenes. So those are the two processes that oil refineries will use. One is not better than the other. So even though this does generate 4 ethylene molecules for the one cracked option, it does depend on what your starting product is. The cost of them is roughly the same. It does take a lot of money to get your steam up to 7 and maintain it at 700 to 1,000 degrees Celsius, just as it does to have a supply of your zeolites and have them refreshed in case they run out too. So both processes are used. It doesn't matter which way you go, but the big idea is just to know that we have our fractions. Some fractions are more useful than others and are in higher demand than others. And we can take the longer ones that aren't in high demand. And there are two ways that we can break them up. We can use zeolites as a catalyst to break the longer chains into smaller chains and get some ethylene out of that, which is great for us. Or we can use thermal cracking with the presence of steam, and again, to get ethylene. So that's the big idea for this video. Watch it a couple of times, make sure you take your consolidation notes on it, and I'll see you in class.